Father God, we love you. We need you. We call upon you and come and pray to you because you are worthy to be praised, because you are the God who is over all, through all, and in all. You are sovereign completely, and we appeal to you, the Most High God. We believe that to be true about you. We also believe that you care about us and that you want to interact with us, that you want to be involved in the details of our lives. That's a special thing. We don't take that for granted. We know that and we'll operate out of that. As we will tonight, pray this food nourishes our bodies and that you would bless our conversations to your glory as well. In the name of your Son, Jesus, and by your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
The face of death, the nearness of eternity, did much to convince me of what books to read, what studies to prefer, what company and conversation to keep. It drove me early into the vineyard of the Lord and taught me to preach as a dying man to dying men. What I want to express to you guys today is just a sense of urgency. Last week we talked about the power of prayer. We talked about the empowerment of God to us and spiritual things. We talked about the physical things that we oftentimes pray for. God, I need food. We need provision. My grandpa is sick. Give him health. Give us wealth. Give us these things that we need. I'd love to get an A on my test. I'd love to graduate. I'd love to get this job. I would love to land at this level. I'd love to land this girl. I'd love to, you know, with the things that we see and the physical needs that we have, the touchable, tangible, sensual things of this world, those are the things that we oftentimes pray for the most. And in doing so, we don't make God a genie. We don't make him Santa Claus. But to a degree, we kind of manage those. You know, God, it says in your word, where two or three gather in your name, there you are with them. And if they agree on anything that they ask for in prayer, then it will be given. So I want a car. There's other verses in the Bible that speak to the potency of prayer. The prayers of a righteous man are powerful and effective. And so that I'm expecting you to do this. I need this thing, and you love me, so why wouldn't you give me this thing? And what I challenged you with last week was to make on a different side, not the physical side, but the spiritual side. And just to help us with what spiritual things are, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Pray these things. Pray for these things. Pray for an extra measure of love. Pray for peace. You know, maybe in the midst of these physical things that you're praying for, maybe what you need the most, the thing that transcends all those things, is peace. You have unrest. You have anxiety. There's something inside of you that isn't settled. And you think that a finite thing is going to fill that up, when really the infinite God is the only thing that can fill that up. Patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. 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 If I was in high school, I'd be praying for self-control 100, 200 times a day. I would need to do that. We live in a world that is, it's in your face. All the touchable, tangible, sensual things in this world are in your face all the time. I'm just giving you guys permission 1,000 times a day to pray to the Most High for self-control. Why? Because God values purity, right? If it's important to God, it should be important to us. So that's where I went last week, the power of prayer. And the empowerment of God through the ministry of the Holy Spirit in us. I mean, there's billions of us all the way. How does God keep track? How can he care for us? Does he care for us? Or did he just set things in motion and then kick back and put his feet up and sip lemonade for the rest of eternity? He cares for you. He wants to be involved in your life. So, now that we have that, now I want to put that urgency to seek him and to pray to him and to choose him over the other things of the world. There's another verse that says this, or another quote that says this: those who taste honey and whey can tell if the whole will be good by just tasting a small portion. It doesn't take too much honey for you to realize it's sweet and I want some more. It doesn't take too much steak to realize, man, this is good, this is sustenance, and I want some more. And it doesn't take a bad bit of fish for you to be like, I'm good, set that to the side. But in the same way with physical things that we taste and that we see that they're good, in the same way we want to taste the Lord and see that He is good. Psalm 34 says this, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him. You know what that means, to take refuge in Him? Because He's your fortress, He's your shelter, He's your protection. He's where you retreat to, He is your God. Take refuge in Him. Blessed are those who take refuge in Him. Fear the Lord, you, His holy people, for those who fear Him lack nothing. Those who revere Him lack nothing. Those who seek Him, those who love Him, those who call upon Him and come and pray to Him lack nothing. Even if they lack the physical thing, they lack nothing because they've got the eternal, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving, everywhere, all the time, God. So my point to you tonight is to encourage you guys to have a sense of urgency. Let's not have it be the face of death that pushes us near God. Our realization of the nearness of eternity may not come on a regular Thursday, right? But with this guy's quote, he said the face of death and the nearness of eternity, his knowledge of the nearness of eternity, it changed him. The books that he read, the studies that he preferred, the company that he kept and the conversation that he had, the music that he listened to, everything he did, every word that he said, it was about God. And so what I want to encourage you guys to is to do two things in your small group. One is to get back to that sweetest taste of God. When was the time in your life that you tasted and saw that God was good? And two, what would it take for you to seek Him every day, to seek Him in that way, to experience Him in that way every day? David, we've tasted and seen that He's good. Why do we forget that? You know, the times that we've tasted Him and seen that He's been good, it's been times where we've been in the Word, it's been time we've been in the body of believers, it's been time where it's been just me alone with God on this mountaintop experience. Or it's been times when, you know, of heartache and trial, and the Lord has brought us through, and he's seen us through, and he's been standing there clearly looking us in the face saying, hey, I'm real, hey, I'm here, hey, I love you, you know. And those are such impactful times, but we tend to forget those things, right? We tend to forget them on Friday or Saturday night. We tend to forget them when we're really seeking to satisfy something inside of ourselves. But one of the things here, what would it look like to, with urgency, look to Him daily? One of the things we brought up at our table, and I want to hear what you guys brought up at your table as well, but it was really just accountability. What would it look like to daily, with urgency, look to God? And I think that, you know, Khalifa's point was, look, I want to feel that every day. And he talked about how, you know, Ben was, you know, gave him a call today. That made him feel good. He's back in the fold right now, and you know, and until he forgets again. But he doesn't have to forget. You know, we can help one another out. When we see each other in the hallways, when we see each other on the street, we can help each other out. We can give an encouraging word. And more than that, and probably more difficult than that, we can ask for it. I'm feeling down. I'm feeling low. I'm forgetting. You know, I've tasted and seen that the Lord is good, which is why I have given Him my eternity. But I want to give Him my everyday too. And I'm having a hard time because I got this thing in front of me. Or I'm having a hard time stressed because of this. Or I'm depressed because of that. But reach out to one another and call them. Call the people at your table, the people in this group, the leaders that are in this group. And just ask them to pray for you. Ask them for an encouraging word. Ask them for something. So that was something that came up at our table. What would you guys come up with? What would it look like to do this every day? What would you guys need to do this every day besides a good memory and accountability? Anyone at y'all's table, y'all discuss anything?
Yeah, we're kind of talking about just needing, you know, how so often we forget. So often we forget, you know, God's faithfulness in the past and just needing to be reminded, you know, having times like this where we remind one another of God's goodness and our dependency on Him.
Okay, good. Anyone else? Thanks, Kevin.
What we talked about was lack of focus. you know, you should be doing this, and it's not that you don't want to do this, or that you think you shouldn't, it's that, oh yeah, I should.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Spiritual ADD.
Or, you know, the simple, oh yeah, bring your what?
Right.
Done.
Yeah.
Then come back.
One of the things that we can do to maintain that focus is,
yeah, I mean, I think the whole idea that we need a savior,
yeah,
like we, it can't be my memory, it can't be my feelings, you know, it can't, like, we need a savior, we need someone else, and to connect to that person, like, what better thing than the Bible, like, what better thing than prayer, church, things that are outside of us,
right,
like, we actually need these things, because we're actually, we're the sinners, you know, we're the, and we're redeemed in Christ, but like we need the Savior every day instead of to feed upon Him and His vital. And so I just think about all the things outside of me that I desperately need. Because it's me that's the problem. It's me that doesn't focus.
That's great.
Great.
Yeah, we just kind of talked about the difference between desiring that time with God and desiring the closest thing, and actually like realizing the necessity for it. That will kind of transform your ability to schedule time.
Yeah, and that's the whole point of reading this quote, you know, the face of death, the nearness of eternity, the depression of my life, the dire straitness of my situation. You know, these are the things that make me realize that this is a necessity. It's not just a, I'm feeling it, so I'm going to do it, but it's a necessity. I think that's great. Chef.
You know, it'll take a lot of patience, I think, because a lot of times we know what is right, but we don't want to do what is right because the other thing is right there. It's like we don't want to wait on God's promise. We want whatever we can get right now.
Yeah.
So
and here's my question to the room. When you're in that moment, are you aware of what you're doing, that it's wrong? You know it's wrong, right? You know what is right, do what is right. If you don't know what is right, God is going to make that clear to you. And sometimes in that moment, it's clear to you.
Indeed.
But you're just like, oh man, God's going to forgive me anyway, so I'm good. And this will be my last time, I promise. You know? What? You know?
Yeah. And you think about it later on and be like, listen, man, I should have never did that.
What did I do? Why did I do that? I'll never do that again. You know? And I think to Stuart's point, I mean, that's such a great point. I mean, we're sinners. This is, our fleshly pattern is just that. Is to continue to time after time trip and fall on our face, which is why we need a Savior. God knew that, so He gave us a Savior in Jesus Christ. And Jesus knew that, which is why He asked God for and God sent the Spirit of Truth to be with us. The Holy Spirit of God is with us all the time. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age, right? That's what it says. But it also links that with doing His work, doing the Great Commission. It's one thing to know God. It's another thing to follow God. It's another thing to carry out His will for your life. You know, this isn't just a buffet line and God's rolled the whole thing out for you. So you're like, today I'll take this and I'll take this today as well. You know, God has given you a commission. He's given you a mission, and He's promised to be with you in that mission. And it's not that if you're not on His mission that He's not going to be with you, but I read a little excerpt from a book this week that was just talking about that very thing. People desire for God to be with them, but they don't do the thing that God asks them to do in the thing that He's going to promise to be with them. So I would just kind of, I wasn't planning on doing this, but it just kind of took a different turn when I pieced that together. Was just maybe challenging you guys. Maybe next week we'll talk about what's it look like to carry out the Great Commission of God. Maybe we're bored with just knowing that God loves us, He saves us, we mess up, He's going to forgive us. Repeat. You know? I think there's more too. We talked about that earlier in the fall. We talked about this idea that we were designed for good, that we were destroyed by evil, that we've been restored to better, and that we've been sent together to help God, to help, not that God would need our help, but he chose to use us for the purpose of his, of this mission. So maybe it's time we step it up and look into what it would look like to do the work that he calls us to do, that he promises to be with us in. Didn't mean to go there. That wasn't on my list here. But yeah, I think that might be good. So that might be where we go next week. But until then, let's focus, let's pray, let's be reminded we need a Savior, let's have accountability, let's understand the necessity of the situation, and let's choose it. Let's choose it. Every day this week, we can choose it. If we don't know how to, let's call one of our buddies or one of the leaders and let them help us with that. Anyone have any questions before we close out? All right, let's pray. Father, we love you, we need you, we thank you and praise you for tonight. We pray that you would stir up in us a desire for you, and that you would stir up in us the recognition of our need for you, our need for a Savior, our need for the Holy Spirit to come in and do a work in us every day for our salvation, for our edification, and for your glory, God. Pray for all these young men in this room that that if they haven't yet, that they would taste and see that you are a good God. And if they have, that in a new way, they would taste and see that you are good and be reminded of that in such a way as where they would never forget it. So I pray these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, whom we need, Jesus, and by your Holy Spirit, who you give us. Amen.